So how did you rediscover your faith? Have you been an atheist or have you just abandoned faith?
When I was 12 years old, I was all Catholic. I was baptized. I did my confirmation. And then at 12 years old, my parents decided not to go to church anymore. So now I had this crazy life. In my old house, the house before this house, we had a ghost in there, a spirit that the whole family saw. My daughter can describe exactly what she looked like. She knew it was a woman. We found out later it was a woman who was who passed away, that a previous owner, and she didn't like me. She attacked me, and in the middle of the night, and very scary, like pressing me in the bed, not able to eat, not to breathe. And the only way for me to was get mentally very angry, and then I would explode in the middle of the night, scream, and then my wife, everybody would freak out, of course. It was the only way to get up, but I couldn't move a muscle, couldn't even breathe anymore. That happened a whole bunch of times. Saw her walking through the house, like literally seeing her walking through the house. I felt one day we came home, and I felt there was somebody in the house. It was 9:30, 10 o'clock at night, and I tell my family to stay at the front door. I said, keep the door open, but I went almost close. If you hear me struggle with somebody, I want you to close and call the cops. Don't worry about me. I'm going to be fine. Don't worry. But there's somebody or something in the house that felt weird. Now, I had this kitchen that was divided. It was a dining room on one side of the wall. And here was an open kitchen that went in the back there. There was the kitchen, the fridge and all that stuff, the stove. And I thought that person was there. So what I did, there was two entrances. I could go to the open kitchen, walk to that back part, or I go to the dining area, and there was this big curtain, like this heavy, thick curtain hanging in front of a doorpost instead of a door that also went to the kitchen. So what I did, I acted like I went to this side, and then suddenly I was loud but talking, hoping that the person would take the bait. I would start walking there. I would make a U-turn, and then I would face the person. I started sprinting, and while I'm running through, the curtain flies up against the ceiling, so I just keep sprinting through, and the family saw it, and there was nobody in the house. Doors were closed, we just came home, everybody goes, yeah, boss, probably the door. I said, we just came home, everything was closed, you know, I'm not leaving doors open, I'm Dutch, we close everything before we leave, trust me on that. But I mean, it didn't move, it flew up against the ceiling, full power. And that was the moment that I thought, okay, there's just way more in this world that we can see, you know, and we can experience. So then a few days later, I challenged it. I would always challenge it. If it would happen in the middle of the night, I would say, okay, I want you to do it now again. I'm going to go to sleep. Do it again, because now I'm going to be ready for you. I want to see, because now you're waiting for me such a long time. It's like a sucker punch. I say, if you're tough, come right now, you know. And then I went under the chandelier, that place where it was always cold. It was the dining room area. And I challenged it there for 45 minutes, I think. I said, come on, let's do this now. You know, I don't like this, the coming behind and hitting me and then going away. If you're really tough, you should do this right now. Now, later when I started thinking about this whole thing, I realized that that woman, my kids, everybody was happy. There was no problem. She was singling me out. And that was the time that I was drinking heavy. Now, I was never a bad drunk. But I was always, there's music, there's dancing, you know, I'm always up and always happy. But always happy, always drunk is not being a good father. It's not going to be a husband. It's not going to be a good man, you know. So I stopped that at the time. Many years later, we were filming a movie, and we have this speaker coming to the set, a theologian. And a friend of mine said, hey, boss, why don't you sit in on the talk this time? Kevin James, he's a Catholic as well. He says, why don't you sit with him? And he started talking about me, about a leaf fell from the tree. And then the leaf was on the ground. That was the end destination of the leaf. And then he started backtracking the leaf. And the way he did that, you come to a conclusion, undeniable. I cannot do it like he does. He actually wrote a book about it, Going Deeper is that, from Leo Severino. It's a really good book. It's not a thick book. But you read that, after you read that, you know we are planted here. This is not an accident. I never believed this was an accident anyway. The one cell going to two cells, I never believed that, because how you sustain life like that, one cell, it's, for me, that was impossible. I always thought, actually, I thought that we were put on this planet by us from the future. That's what I always thought. You know, so for me to make that switch to going, oh, us from the future, or there is a God who did this, was a very simple step. You also have to remember, when I was 10 years old, Meester Jos, you remember the guy I didn't like? He's a bad guy. And I remember in his class, I was 10 years old, looking outside the tree, out the window. And it was a tree. And he's trying to get my attention. And I hear the class laughing. And suddenly he's screaming. I go, because I'm in a zone. I'm looking at a tree. And this is a very vivid memory from me. And then he's screaming, "Ruin that!" I go, "What?" He goes, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm looking at that tree." He goes, "What about the tree?" I go, "How did the tree get here?" And he goes, "Dude, they planted that, stupid." I said, "No, that's not what I'm saying. How? But the tree before that, when you go all the way back, where do trees come from? Where did it start? When was the first tree? When did it start?" So when Leo started, the leaf fell from the tree, started backtracking the leaf to where it eventually all began. Mm-hmm. And then with a solid proof of the very existence of God, I was like, okay, you see, now that with me, what happened with the ghost, I knew already there was negativity going on. By the way, that challenging of the ghost, I did at 3 a.m. at night. I had no clue that Jesus passed away at 3 p.m. I wasn't in the faith. And at 3 a.m. would be the dark forces are the most active at 3 a.m. This is the opposite of when Christ passed. Mm-hmm. You know, I had no clue, but yet I was there at 3 o'clock doing it. You know, so all these little things, when you start looking back, that fits together. It's almost like they were planting seeds in my head. Mm-hmm. Until suddenly I heard the talk from Leo, and I go, oh, man, this is the wildest thing. You know, I can talk a lot about that because there's so many things that happened along the way. But, you know, that's maybe for a different show because then people are going to go, oh, what's going on? Most of the time when you start talking about the faith, that's why I don't. People are going to go, they zone out right away. It's right away, oh, the pedophile priest. And it's they blame it on people. You know, and I always go, oh, so, okay, so what you're saying is that if your math teacher who taught you 8+8, because let's face it, the New Testament is all truth and it's all love. Nobody can deny that. You can be a biggest atheist, but you cannot say that. You have to forgive everybody 70 times, 70 times, over and over. It's all about love and things, right? That's 100% true. That's what Jesus said he was established. But truth is also math, right? 8+8 is 16. But what if your math teacher had a sexual relationship? What if one of the math teachers on the planet had a sexual relationship with a minor? Is 8+8 still 16? And they look at me, I go, yeah, of course it's still 16. Well, see it like that. Jesus said, this is the church. This is how good. Yeah, and along the way, bad people come who try to destroy the church from within. It's what we're seeing right now. It's actually the Apostle Paul talked about that. It will happen like that. They will act like they're, you know, one of us apostles. They come into the church, and from the inside, they're going to try to throw it away. Once you hear these stories with these pedophile priests, what came out now last time, the 300-something, with the upside-down crosses that they did, and they crucified a little kid, like not with nails, but hanging him on the cross. I mean, that is satanic, right? So that means he was 100% right. They started like that and they tried to ruin it from the inside. So once you can overcome that and you just realize these are bad people, this is not what Jesus said, you know, that problem is solved. Unfortunately, I was like that. I would say that the first time somebody came to me, oh, you're Catholic? So you're Catholic? Yeah, oh, pedophile priest. I would do the same thing because I didn't learn about it. Well, once you learn about it and you wake up and you're smart about it, you go, it's just bad people. Look at the first 12 apostles. We already had a bad one there, right?
So do you believe in specifically in the Catholic Church and Jesus and in the scriptures as being verbatim, or is it more of a because the idea of that something had to be initiated at some point by someone, right? There's a higher power that has to initiate. That's a very generic, let's say, idea that you can have. So it's not specific to the Catholic Church, for example. So would you say you're more a Catholic guy or more a spiritual guy?
No, I'm Catholic all the way, like 100%. I think it's the one only true church. You know, they say that's the one that's established by Jesus Christ. And people can say, oh, that's the Protestant church too. No, it's not. Martin Luther established that church. It's different. He took some books out, 7 books out, and there's some changes that he made, you know, so that's not established by Jesus pure. It's changed on the way over. You know, if you read the Christ connection, if you find out that the 2,000 years before Christ was born in the book of the Hindu, which is the oldest religion in the world, in the book of the Hindu, and 2,000 years before Christ was born, somebody would get born from a virgin. He would get spit out by the people. Mm-hmm. He would be bound to a stick. His hand and feet would be pierced, but his bones would not be broken. He would wear a crown of thorns. Mm-hmm. He would drink a sour drink. And then the last one was 7 identical lines from the Passion, 2,000 years before this happened. You can read it. It's in the book, right?
Yes. Right.
And the last one was that they said, oh, no, this cannot be true. Because in order to sustain life and to go there, you had to eat him and drink him. They thought they were talking about cannibalism, you know? And then you go 2,000 years later, Jesus got born from a virgin. You get this whole story that is predicted 2,000 years before that in the book of the Hindu. You can find it right there. And there's more religions also. There's the coming of Christ. The Christ Connection is a book by Roy Verghese. And it's really interesting when you read those things. And then once you really start diving into it, because you always try, in the beginning, you know, you want to learn more. You want to believe more. Because you still, if you can't see it, like I experienced it. I saw it. I saw things flying around. I know it's 100% there. But for other people, yeah, seeing is believing, right? Mm-hmm. And I pray for a month and nothing happened. You know, he doesn't exist. Yeah, okay. So you didn't do anything your whole life. You did everything wrong. Sin, all the bad things that you did. And in a month, you're entitled to suddenly need some help from God. Come on, guys. But it's like being not training for 10 years and then I trained for a month. I want to fight a world title fight. It's not really working like that, you know? You have to really dive into it. And I really found it, and I think it's really important. I mean, the things that you read and the prophetic messages they have. And yes, by the New Testament I live, you know, that's what I want. I would love to have, you know, the understanding and to, you know, forgive and forget and do all that stuff and be more peace and calm. It's great. Yeah, the Old Testament, there's some hard stuff in there. People are going to go, whoa, that's a little hard. But that's not what Christians live by, you know. We all live by what Jesus established.
You talking about books, you mentioned you're big, as I saw some other interview with you, you're a big fan of The Alchemist by Paulo Coelho. Talk a little bit about that, because I read that book many years ago. It was a very influential book for myself as well. I really liked the book. Can you talk a little bit about that? What meant in life, and maybe give two, no, it's impossible, but a 5-sentence summary of what the story of the book is, because it's really about finding your path in life, right?
It's finding your personal legend. So that's to see, you can replace it with everything, your goal in life, whatever you want to do. And with him, it was a treasure, you know, in this book, this particular book. It's just a sheep herder, you know, who goes on this mission to look for his personal legends. And he meets all these people on the way, along the way, that change him, that put him back on the course. Every time when he strains away from the path, you know, he meets a person and then boop, he jumps back on again. And he realizes, he calls them omens, like things or people you meet those for a reason. I tell my students always and everybody, my daughters, you know, you meet people for a reason, you know. And if you meet a person, you think, oh, maybe I got to have to listen to the person. And this book is so smart because it's a normal story. Nobody told me that I was actually going to learn from it. So while I was reading it, I go like, man, that's a great thing what he did. And once you keep reading, you realize, oh, wow, it's really imprinting all the things that you need to have in order to be a good person or a successful person. You know, it's hidden in the story because you think it's just a guy, a sheep herder. That's what he is. But once you start reading it, then you realize that your mind gets programmed a certain way. And it is so, so good for you. I read it a whole bunch of times now. Every friend of mine, I told everybody to read it. It's very good. I just read a book, The Icon Effect. And it's pretty much the same. And it's about business, a business guy who's down. And, you know, and they have these rules, these 25 rules. And every time a rule pops up, and my buddy gave it to me. And he said, boss, if you read this, you cannot stop it. You will read it one time. So I took the first page and started reading when I flew to New York. Mm-hmm. And I finished it when I was in New York. I was like, holy Martin, this is one of the best books. It's also, you read it, it's a normal story, but you get these little rules. And if you live by those rules as a business person, mm-hmm. it will really help you. Another one, and it's Matthew McConaughey, actually. He put me onto that. It's The Greatest Salesman in the World, which is a book. But it takes 10 months to read because there's 10 chapters, and every chapter you have to read 3 times a day mm-hmm. for a month straight. And then you can go to the next chapter. And what that is doing, it's programming your mind. Because at the beginning, you're reading it. But after 12 days, 13 days, you realize you memorize your whole 5-minute, 6-minute little talk. You know, you can do it on top of your head. You do it in the morning, during the day, first thing in the morning, during the day, and just before you go to sleep. And you do that for 30 days, boom, it's locked in. And a lot of the things that he's talking about are, you know, but you don't live by them. You realize that you know that and you should live by them, but you don't do it anymore. It's kind of watered down, you know? So then you pick that up again. And that, I really enjoyed that book as well.
Oh, okay. So, Bas, I mean, Bas, I don't want to get it wrong. Is Bas short for?
Sebastian. Okay. He's a badass saint. He's the only saint who got martyred twice, actually. They shot him. He told the king at the time, the emperor, what he was doing wrong with the Christians. And then they put the bottom on the stick, they start shooting him full of arrows. He survived that. Somebody brought him back to life. Then he went straight back to the guy, did it again. This time they didn't let him go, though. They clubbed him to death. But he's the only saint. He was a saint. He's the saint of athletes also. So he was a Roman commander in the Roman Empire.
Okay. So what's next for you? Where's your path leading you? What are your next projects?
My next project is called the WBKFF, the World Bare Knuckle Fighting Federation. It's legal. It's big in England right now.
Okay.
And it started here in America now too. In Wyoming is a state where it's legal, legalized bare knuckle boxing.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And November 9th, I have the first show. I just became the president of that company. Mm-hmm. They have been asking me for a lot. I do karate as well. Mm-hmm. It's called Karate Combat. I'd like to do, and I do mixed martial arts as commentating as well. And then they wanted me to be a president of this new MMA organization. I said no, because there's so many out there. But when they came with bare knuckle, I go, wow, that could be really cool. Did my homework first, because I needed to make sure. I knew already in my mind that it was safer than boxing, but I had to look it up. And so once I start Googling it, people can, because now people are going to watch this and they go like, he's an idiot. It's more safer than boxing. Just Google it. It's safe. Is bare knuckle boxing safer than boxing? Yeah. And all the guests will say it is. People at home who don't understand martial arts, they think the glove is invented to protect the head of the opponent. It's not invented for that. It's to protect the hand, because people were breaking their hands on the skull all the way back, and then they couldn't defend their title. So they go, dude, this is not good. We got to come up with something so they don't break their hands anymore. That's how the boxing glove gets invented. Now, when the boxing glove got invented, now there's no reason to hold back anymore. You can hit as hard as you want, and you're not going to break your hand anymore. In bare knuckle boxing, all these guys, those pros, they hit 50% of the power to the head, and they go hard to the body. But they don't want to hit the head hard, because if they hit the skull,
they're going to break their hands. Yeah.
So yes, you have lacerations, you have that stuff, but that's superficial. You know, it's just on the top of it. It doesn't cause CTE, right? Yeah. So enthalopathy, right? Chronic traumatic encephalopathy. That's it. It's a very hard word to pronounce. But CTE is a big thing now in boxing, right? With the and even with American football here also.
Yeah, you have all the late stage brain damage, depression caused by that. So you have many suicides in pro athletes. Yeah.
Yeah. So now that was the first thing I did when I heard about bare knuckle boxing. I started Googling about it, and they said, no. Yeah, you have cuts, and people go down with body shots. The last show they had, it was not this company, another company. There was one knockout from like 15 fights and one broken hand. Mm-hmm. And the rest, maybe you got stopped because of a cut, but nobody got knocked out anymore. So it's actually safer. And that was the reason that I said, okay, then I want to do it. Now, don't get me wrong, if it goes completely out of hand, which I don't think it is, because it's working for such a long time and in England already, then nothing can go wrong. I don't want anybody to get hurt, of course. As long as I know that they can keep speaking to their family, instead of start slurring the words, that would not be good for me. So a little cut here and there. For guys, for what I understand, the girls dig scars, right? That's what they always say.
Girls dig real men. Right. But do you think there's a chance that this will ever get sanctioned nationwide? Because, I mean, it's much more graphic in a way. It's not as bad from a injury perspective, but it's much more graphic. You will get the cuts, you will get lacerations and stuff like that. So there will be bloods, and people will say, oh God, this is just another freak show, and we will never sanction that. Do you think there's a chance that this will ever be?
Especially now it goes on, the whole world is turning into a sissy, right? You can't do anything anymore. You can't say anything anymore.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's insane. So, but I'm very easy. Like golf, for instance, is not my cup of tea. Do I shout against it? No. Do I scream against it? No. If I zap a channel and it's golf, and I just click the next channel. Very simple. I'm not going to stay and look at it and start spinning fire, go online and start saying bad things about it. It makes no sense. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's why I believe it probably won't be a regular TV kind of thing, but this is a pay-per-view show. And I think people who buy the pay-per-view, you know, they're already kind of used to that stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, a cut for people, it's like I stitch myself up. You know, whatever I do or my students, you know, I don't have a problem with that. But for regular people, that's really weird. I had my eyes were completely closed, and I just got my doctor. I said, give me a syringe with a white gouge. And I just stabbed it in there, and I just sucked the blood out. And, you know, for me, that's a normal thing to do. And then one time I heard a fighter who was in that room at the same time. I heard him tell that story to somebody else, like 15 years later. He says, this dude, man, he takes off his shades, he puts, takes a syringe in his stomach, he starts sucking the blood out, and I go, oh, he's talking about me, right? But the way he was talking, I go like, oh, yeah, now that sounds a little weird, right? Because it's so normal for us, but it's not normal for other people. So when they see blood all over the face and they wipe the blood, most of the time it's a little tiny cut somewhere.
Yeah.
And they blood because the heart rate is pumping.
The head bleeds incredibly fast and quite a lot, so quite intensely.
Yeah. So, you know, that's, and once two people can step over that, if you don't like blood, don't watch it. I say, don't watch it.
Easy solution. Yeah. Well, yeah. So, I don't want to keep you longer. I know you're quite busy. And, I mean, also maybe the one last thing, your, oxygen trainer, that's something I wanted to because I think that's a great product and maybe you can just quickly talk about that before we close up.
Well, here we go again with the asthma, right? I would have at the time when I was very sick as a kid, I was still doing track and field because my whole family does track and field. My brother is really good at it. But I started getting really good at it as well. And I wanted to become, believe it or not, the Dutch Bruce Jenner because he was the guy, he was the 1976 gold medalist triathlon. No, decathlon. And I wanted to do that as well. I was good javelin, discus, shot put, running, high jump. I had everything good. For my asthma, the 1500 meters, of course, was the hardest thing for me to do. And the 400 meters because that's my lungs. But for the rest, I was going really well. Mm-hmm. Now, if I would have an asthma attack, and then I would, after that attack, it's, let's say 8 days in bed, being not able to breathe, I would resume my track and field, and every single time when I would do that, I would run faster, and I would break my running times.
Wow. Okay.
And it freaked me out. Mm-hmm. And I go, why is that? Maybe it's the medication they gave me. Maybe it's the cortisone. You know, it has to be. So why do I every time? And then it goes slowly, but surely goes away again, and I'm back to my old numbers. And I had to learn how to breathe, you know. So every month you go as a kid, you take an hour breathing classes from a doctor, from a specialist. And when I went to the office, I saw a drawing of a pair of lungs on the wall in a frame. Mm-hmm. And I saw that the infection is not in your lungs. It's in the air pipes that go to the lungs. As a kid, you think it's in the lungs, lung infection. That's what you think, right? It's not. It's the air pipes that go towards the lungs. Mm-hmm. And you saw one air pipe next to each other and one that was completely closed with all slimy stuff in there. And that was literally, I was 14 years old. I go, that was the light bulb. I go, oh man, I've been working out my lungs for 8 days in a row. Yeah. I've been putting air into this little tiny hole. Mm-hmm. So then when the infection is gone and everything is open,
your respiratory system is stronger.
Yeah. And that's why I run better. Why don't I come up with something that controls the air intake? That was literally my idea. And over the years, I start telling everybody, you know, you're at a party and somebody says, oh, I have an invention. And they tell their invention. I say, oh, I have an invention. But every time when I would tell my invention, they would say, you got to make that thing, boss. Because somebody's going to come up with that. That's a really good idea what you have. And it went on and on until I was in America. And suddenly a fighter, Wanderlei Silva, he was training his fighters apparently with a snorkel. Breathing in through a snorkel, just a snorkel. And my phone went crazy. I got text messages from everybody. And I called it the routinizer at the time. We called it the O2 trainer now, but the routinizer, that was the name for it, just for fun. And he says, dude, the routinizer, you got to make it. Everybody start telling me. He says, somebody's going to come up with it because, look, he's already training through a tube, you know, and it might look like that. So I started made a prototype. I started training with the prototype. I was a severe asthma patient my entire life. Every fight I had in the dressing room, I always have to spray my lungs open. Oh, everywhere I traveled in the world, I had to carry an inhaler because if I would sneeze three times very violently, like hard, my lungs closed, have to take them up again, spray them open. Within 3 weeks, my asthma was cured. Gone. 3 weeks.
Crazy.
So I'm telling my buddy in Holland who has asthma, I said, I'm going to send you one. Him, 2 weeks. Cured. He sells them now in Europe because he goes, dude, this is crazy. Cure me. One night right now, I have 100% success rate. Everybody who uses it for asthma, they don't have asthma anymore. Can I medically claim it? No, because I don't have the money to do those tests yet. I do have medical journals, published medical journals, that tell you what it does for you. So that I have, because I got in contact with the trainer from Usain Bolt. Mm-hmm. He wrote a really bad article about the competition that I have. I won't say the name because, but he, he wrote a bad article about that. My manager told me about that article. And I said, hey, listen, do me a favor. Find the guy who wrote that article. I want to send him a note to a trainer. He said, are you sure you want to do that? Because what if it's bad? I said, it's not. They control the air in and out. Mine only controls the air in. It's the only way to go. I know this is the only way to go. Because then you can completely exhale before you inhale again. So you can use your whole inspiratory system to get stronger. And he calls the guy, finds the guy, picks up the phone. Hey, I'm representing Bas Rutte. And before he continues his sentence, the guy goes, oh, the O2 trainer. He says, we're already using that.
Oh, yeah.
This guy has a higher IQ than freaking Einstein. This guy trains Usain Bolt, 3 other gold medalists. You know, this is a big fish now. And he's already using it. So now I teamed up with him. And he's got all those published medical journals where it's proven what it does. You know, so they're on my website now. And you can read those. Right now, it's just, you know, I'm trying to contain it still. We're going to have, I think, in about 1 month, I'm going to have 15,000 in stock. Mm-hmm. And that's because we build it up ourselves. It costs so much money for the patents and the worldwide patents and everything that I had to do. I mean, so much money I put in there. Yes, other people want to jump on board now, but then they want 40% of the company. I said, listen, I did it to myself. I'm going to finish it myself. So now every time the investment's coming back, we get more and more and more. And until we have 15, 20,000 in stock, then I'm going to go on a show like Dr. Oz. I'm going to bring Chet Macias, that's the trainer from Usain Bolt, with me on the show. Then we have the public medical, the published medical journals, you know, where it's proven, because this is always fun, right? If you have somebody, oh, it's clinically tested. Yeah, so it sucks.
Why? It doesn't mean anything. It's been tested with better results.
If it would have been a good result, you would have said that, but it isn't. So it's not a good thing. You see, I mean, it makes no sense. This is clinically proven, 100% proven. It's a published medical journal. That means it's 100% proven. So it's a big step. I'm just going to have to wait till I have many in stock, because I don't want to be that guy that starts selling a lot and sell out and going to have to wait 5 weeks to the next shipment. People are going to be happy to kill the company. So I'm just doing a slow out together with my wife. And that's it. We pretty much run the whole thing. Well, she does the most work, trust me.
Okay. And why did that you need to have a free... the option to exhale freely. Why is it not better to restrict both in and out?
Okay, because so
if you push hard, it would also train your lungs. Like out. So that's what I don't get.
Yeah, but no, you can, but not together. So the reason is this: first of all, it's a very simple concept. It's like a thing that has two outsides. Mm-hmm. One side has a screen on it, a flap. If I breathe out, it goes open. If I breathe in, it closes, which will force you to breathe into this side. It's a little thing. It's not a big thing.
I've seen it. Yeah. Let's see.
And but for the people at home, there comes with a hole, a millimeter hole, 2 millimeter, 3, 4, 5, 6, all the way to 50. So you can very slowly, gradually go down in size hole, and you get with resistance. Now, if you breathe in with resistance and you need air really fast, you want to breathe out. If you breathe out with resistance, you can't completely empty your lungs. Because if you're getting tired, you need new air again. So what you start doing, if you control air in and out, you start breathing shallow because there's still air in the lungs the whole time. With mine, you can breathe in, takes out, and then you can completely exhale. You can't do that with resistance. Oh, I'm tired again. You got to breathe in again. But you still have like 40% of air in your lungs, and then you breathe in again. That's not a good thing. If you can completely empty your lungs, you can use the whole inspiratory system to get back up. Especially now Now the guy actually wants to be partner with me, the other one. So, because they figured it out as well, that it's the only way to go. So, but now, that ship has sailed. There was some things said in the beginning. And I said, I just wait because I know my article. They said, oh, it sucks. You got to control air in and out. And I knew I was right. And 8 years later, I found out I was right. That was really sweet for me.
That's great. Fantastic. Yeah. Hey, Bas, so thank you very much. It was really a very, very interesting conversation. I would love to go on for hours, but you got a few other things to do. I want to close with two questions. And the first question is, this series of interviews I'm doing is about extraordinary people. So people who do things that are, you know, that bring this world a step further, who have special experiences, who change the world or shape the world in a certain way. Who would you say is such an extraordinary person to you that I might even talk to next?
Well, I would say I can't get Bruce Lee, but of course he passed away. I did the next best thing, though. I interviewed his daughter, Shannon Lee. That was an awesome thing. But people who changed the world. Nick Newell. I would say Nick Newell is a fighter with a congenital amputee, or he has half an arm, I met him a long time ago on the movie set, Here Comes the Boom. Mm-hmm. That was in 2000, so a long time ago. He was one of the extras walking around there, and he came to me with half an arm, mm-hmm. and he told me to remember his name because he was going to be a famous fighter mm-hmm. in mixed martial arts. And I'm looking at him. I said, "You tell me that you're going to fight with that arm." Yeah. I said, "Dude, I wish you all the best." I got his address. Mm-hmm. I sent him all my workouts that I had developed, like DVDs and workouts. I sent it to him because I thought, man, that would be great. Many years later, this guy became a champion. He became an MMA champion. He fought 14 fights, lost only two, one by decision, one he got stopped, but that was a very tough fight. It was a title fight for a different company. But I mean, I think he, from his 12 wins, I think he had three decisions. The rest, he finished everybody. I mean, it's just an amazing guy, what you can do with half an arm. Like my arm, I couldn't hold it, my phone, and I couldn't hold anything anymore. But my neck surgery, I had the compressed nerves. And I was complaining, I couldn't do anything anymore. And then I thought about Nick. And I go, man, I'm such a sissy. He doesn't even have a hand, right? Now I can use my hand again. I should be happy enough. Yes, it's 30% of the power that it had before, but I still have a whole arm. This guy has half an arm and he became a champion with it. That's the guy, you know, I go, that's an inspiring person. I like that a lot.
Great. So I'll just reach out to him. But it's crazy what people can do with limitations that seem impossible. I've told you a few weeks back, I spoke to a woman named Jessica Cox. She's a motivational speaker and she was born without arms. So she doesn't have any stubs, nothing. It's like just shoulders and nothing else.
I saw it this morning. You sent it to me and she's on the phone with her freaking, with the foot.
Yeah. She puts her contact lenses in with her feet. And she's
played piano, right? I saw her feet on the piano, the toes. That's crazy.
And she's a licensed pilot. I mean, that's crazy. And she did, when she went, we talked for a while, and when she went to the flight instructor, he said, we can't have you have a separate test because, you know, the regulations are that everyone needs to have the same test. So she did the flight license with the same test, with the same airplane, like everyone else with arms. So she has to be able to do everything with her 2 feet that an able-bodied person would have to do. And then she passed it. She's a scuba diver. She's a parachuter. She's it's crazy. I mean, it's crazy. And then you talk about limitations. I mean, I can't do this. I'm too tired. I didn't have my cup of coffee in the morning. Like, yeah, yeah.
You know, I did that I did as a kid. They always asked me, how can you deal with it, with the eczema and everything? And I said, well, I notice people out there that have way worse than I, who have that eczema that had really bad on my hands. They're completely covered with that. I know there are people out there who have the asthma attack that I have for only a week. They have it 365 days a year. There's always people who have it more, and they still, many of them, are able to pull off these amazing things. And what you just talked about, that's, I mean, I saw the pictures, you know, with the feet on the piano and driving the car. You know,
yeah, it's
so amazing what people can do. You see, that's, I love that. That's the same with Lizzie Velasquez.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That, and it's such a bad title, but she's kind of embracing that. And then she's, you know, speaks up against bullying. And, you know, what a power, you know, as a woman, you know, if you have that disease to come out on top. And to, you know, to inspire the world. I love people like that. I have a cousin who has problems, you know, and he's gaining weight and he used to do heroin and drinking and all that stuff. And I go, dude, he lost 110 pounds in like 4 months' time. Mm-hmm. And he says that he's a loser. And I go, yes, you are. You're big. You lost a lot of weight. I mean, it's insane. I said, dude, you win a TV show here in America with that kind of weight, losing 110 pounds.
It's insane. Crazy.
You know, and you saying that you are a loser, that's so incredibly hard what you're doing right now, and you're doing it, you know. So I hope he gets inspired a little bit more, because sometimes he falls off the wagon and then he's back on. But yeah, it's amazing what people can do. And I had that with Nick Newell too. And then, yeah, Lizzie Velasquez, I really like her message as well.
Well, very interesting. Bas, final words. So what do you want to do? What kind of message do you want to give to the viewers and to the listeners of this show? What's the message that's closest to your heart?
It's doing unto others, right? That's what I always say. It's like, just treat people like you want to be treated. I know this is used a lot, this line, and I know that. Yet 90% of the people who say it are not living by it. That's the problem nowadays. Everything is so short and fast, you know, so many characters only. Everything is short attention span. That's the government. They just try to get your attention away and give it to commercials and all that stuff. It's very sad what's going on in the world. Everybody's breaking up and start dating through phones. I mean, there's dating services. Nobody can go out anymore to meet people. Are you insane? I mean, so treat people like you want to be treated. It's very simple. You know, if you do something to a person, I always think, before I actually do something, or before I'm going to tell my person, like let's say I go to a friend of mine and I'm about to give him constructive criticism, I always flip, I always put the shoe on the other foot, and I always say, what would I feel if he would come to me? You know, now this is a thing I learned, because as a fighter, you have an ego, you need an ego, you need to make yourself the best guy on the planet. You know, little doubt can be really bad for you in a fight. So you have to need a chip on your shoulder, and hopefully you can shake that off after you're done fighting. You know, so you have to learn to live with that. If I tell a fighter constructive criticism, they don't really like that. But the good ones, they ask me. They say, please do. And thankfully, I changed a lot like that for me as well. Long time already. I always listen to constructive criticism. Open your ears. What they have to say. Another pair of eyes. You know, it's always good to have. If they're right, start doing it. If they're wrong, thank them very much. But I stick to my own game. It can be very nice. It doesn't need to be, stupid. No, just listen to somebody. So do to people as they would do unto you. That's literally what I'm saying. And live by it. Not just say it, live by it.
Wonderful. Lars Rotten, I thank you so much for your time. It's been a pleasure, and I hope talking to you very soon. Thank you very much.
Okie dokie. Thanks, Rob. Bye-bye. Take care.